Thank you so much for being with us today at the Benson Pitch Church. I want to make you welcome. It's going to be a great day in the Lord. We're excited to be in the house of God. I hope you are as well. And some great things are happening online, family. We make you welcome as well this morning. And I just want to share a couple of things with you. And you share it with your neighbors, because some will come in a little bit later after we get started with the service. But one is this. Let's not forget, today starts our new class of Let's Go Deeper. You know, we just went through a study of Follow Me, written by Lee Grady. It's a great study, and we learned the importance of discipleship and the importance of finding a Paul and a Timothy in our life. And now we just want to apply what we've learned. So I'm going to ask you, and I would even beg you, please, try to find one of those classes that you can get into and just take another step. We've got three classes on Sunday morning, starting at 10:15. Brother Joe Dan and also Brother David Barber will continue with their class. And also Sister Susan and Brother Tony Allen, Sister Angel Register, will continue with their class. A new one is going to be in the sanctuary, and that's geared more toward the younger families and those with young children. And Sister Taylor, it's okay, she's my daughter, it'll be okay. She's probably not watching this morning just yet. But Brother Chris Beasley, Sister Taylor Beasley, I was about to call her Fields also, but she wouldn't like that. But anyway, they're going to be teaching a class here, so that's going to be going well. And also tonight at 6, Sister Leanne Hardy, Brother Dylan Hardy, they'll be teaching a class as well. So you have four great opportunities to be a part of this study. Now, if you can't make that one, I would encourage you to continue to come to your Tuesday morning class. Those weekday warriors, they're going through the book of Hebrews, and that's a powerful study. We're thankful for that. And then all of you, I'd love for you to come back on Wednesday night. Now, Sister Child's teaching a class with the Hope Ministry, and Brother Chris and myself are teaching how to study the Bible. If you were not here on Wednesday, I would love for you to go and watch that one online, because we just went through some basic steps of what's involved in studying your Bible. It was a great study. And we're going to take the second step of that, which is the interpretation part. So it's the book of Philemon, real simple book of the Bible. But bring your materials this week. So your study Bibles, your Bible dictionaries, things of that nature. And we're going to study that together. There is one correction. Sister Joy Parker was about to start a class on how to pray. But, you know, I think she wants to wait just a little bit longer. And we've taught some, because there's a lot of people who have an interest in studying the Bible. So when we conclude this in 3 weeks, she's going to teach that one to the sanctuary as well. So that'll be coming. So you don't have to miss her class either. And we're going to be doing that together. So it's going to be a great time in the Lord. So that'll make some of you happy, I know, because you were torn between the two. That's what's going on. Great things the Lord is doing. We give Him praise. There's one more class I'm extremely excited about, and that's our new member class. We've got two more weeks of it. You know, right now there's probably, unless there's a mistake, there's 33 people between the two services that have an interest in joining the church. Yeah, go ahead and give the Lord praise. That's so exciting. You know, during the COVID time, you know, it could sort of get you down, but to see what the Lord is doing, we just give Him praise for that. Now, some of you are here and you're going to be a part of that class. Just let me repeat something. If you have missed the first or the second class, today's meeting is very necessary. Okay, I'll be meeting in the fellowship hall at 10:15 after this service. But if you have been to the first and second class, or perhaps you have an interest and you went through the classes with me maybe a year ago, but you chose at that time not to go through the class, you're okay. But I do need you to speak to me, because some of you may need to get a letter of transfer from a church. And it's always important that we finish strong. I was told one time that you can't start well unless you finish well. So as we start this new journey together, there might be some things we just need to close up and just say goodbye to, okay? It's going to be a great day in the Lord. I'm so excited that you're here with me today. I want to read one verse of Scripture, and I want you to help me pray. The book of Psalms 100 says this: "Enter into His gates with thanksgiving, and into His courts with praise. Be thankful unto Him and bless His name." Amen. Yeah. I wonder if I could encourage you to stand on your feet. Sister Joy's going to come up here with me on the stage. But I wonder if 90 seconds, if we all could just apply that verse without asking God for one thing at all, but just to thank Him and to obey His word, that we've entered His gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. I can just ask you this. Do you have something to thank him for? You do? Amen. He's been good to many of us. Okay, online family, you can do the same thing as well. Why don't we just take those 90 seconds and in your own way, just thank the Lord that he made this day possible and you're in his place today. Okay, can we do that together? Father, we love you. We praise you. As a body, we lift your name up today, dear God. We want to honor you. We want to glorify your name. You are the Almighty God. You're all powerful. You're all knowing. Dear God, this is the day that you have made, and we choose to rejoice. We choose to be glad in it, dear God. You woke us up this morning, and you allowed us to come back to your house. We look around, we see brothers and sisters of the faith. We look around and we see some we haven't seen in a while, but you've allowed us to gather back together, and we're hearing your name. And Lord God, you made it possible. We bless you today, dear God. We thank you that there's a desire in our heart to be in your house, a desire in our heart to give you praise, dear Lord. And so we enter your gates as you've told us to, with thanksgiving, and we enter your courts with praise, and we bless your mighty name. We love you, Lord, and we praise you, Lord God. We thank you. We bless you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. While you're still standing, there's another verse, though. It says this. It says, for the Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting, and his truth endureth to all generations. You know, we've come here today, and we all know he's good. But there's some people in our congregation, and there's some people who are watching online, and today they need to know how good God is, because they're hurting today. They're struggling today. They're sick today. People like Les and Sherry Goodwin would love to be in the house of God. People like Russell Spencer would love to be here with us today. And they need a touch from God. And you probably know someone. Why don't you just lift your hand if you know somebody that just needs to know God is good. Now's the time we can pray for them. Sister Joy is going to lead us, but I want you to pray together. Anybody that you know that's sick, anybody you know that's hurting, anybody you know that's struggling, let's pray God reveals how good he is to them today. All right, Sister Joy.
Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, you are good. And Lord, we know, God, that everything that you do is good in the name of Jesus. But Lord, in this life that we live in, Lord, there's situations that don't seem good, Lord. But God, you've your children, God. Lord, we pray that this morning that you would remind them of your goodness, that you would remind them, Jesus, that you love them with an everlasting love. Remind them, Lord, that there is no distance in prayer in the name of Jesus. God, we lift up Brother Les and Sister Sherry in the name of Jesus. God, we lift up Sister Rachel to you in the name of Jesus. God, we pray, God, that you would begin, Holy Spirit, to minister to them, that they would feel your love, that they would feel your goodness in the name of Jesus, beginning to enter into the situation that they're in. God, we bind the enemy, God, that would try to tell them that your plans are not good. In the name of Jesus, we bind the enemy that would try to cause doubt. God, in the name of Jesus, we pray, Lord, that no matter what they're going through, Jesus, Lord, that they would sense the goodness and the love and the power and the healing that comes from your holy presence. Spirit of God, Holy Spirit, walk throughout this place. We welcome you, Holy Spirit. We welcome you, Holy Spirit. Walk in and out. Walk throughout the pews, Lord. Holy Spirit, walk on this stage. Touch each one. Touch each one, Lord. Don't let anybody leave this place not being touched by your presence. Holy Spirit, you can see inside of the hearts. You see what they're in need of. If it's repentance, let them know, Jesus, that you are a forgiving God. That, Jesus, you paid the price. They don't have to carry the burden of sin anymore, Lord. Speak, Holy Spirit. Do a work that only you can do. Holy Spirit, if there's any here, Lord, that needs to forgive, help them, Lord, to let it go. Help them to lay it at your feet. pray, Lord, that you would begin to minister individually to hearts. There's some that are hurting, Lord. Lord, that they almost didn't come today. They almost let the enemy convince them to stay home. But Holy Spirit, you came along beside of them and you told them to get up, to go to the house of God, to go to a house of prayer, to come. Oh, that you've got something for them. You could have blessed them where they were, but Lord, there was a condition that by faith they had to come. So God, today release what it is you have for your people today, Lord. Oh God, if there are marriages today, God, that are struggling, Holy Spirit, come and bring that reconciliation. Oh, praise God. Holy Spirit, do what only you can do. But Lord, let our worship and our praise come up into you and let it magnify you. Let it be good, because we said it's good to come to the house of the Lord. Thank you, Father. We commit it all to you in Jesus' name. Jesus.
Amen. Would you just turn to your neighbor and tell him, I've come to worship the Lord today. He is worthy of praise. He has amazing grace this morning. Amen and amen. Let's worship the Lord.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, sing for all that you've done for me.
We thank you today, Lord, for giving us life. Thank you, Jesus. And life more abundantly in Him today. Hallelujah. We just give you everything today, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah.
Take
Lord, we just want you to have your way in our lives. Lord, your joy is full and it's never ending. Lord, we just look that day, dear God, when we can sing with the angels and the elders, dear God. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. Lord, no matter what we go through on this earth, dear God, there's nothing that's going to compare to the glorious riches we're going to receive when we walk through those gates of heaven. To sit at the foot of a holy God and just worship.
You deserve the glory.
service today, knowing that you are worthy of it all. You're worthy of every praise. And we just praise your name, dear God, and thank you for the cross. And today we give you our heart, dear God, our whole heart, our whole mind, and our whole soul, that we can be used for your glory and your glory alone in these last days. Lord, comfort those that need comfort in it, God. Give peace to those that need peace. Let us walk in your righteousness today, dear God. In your name I pray, amen. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. You may be seated today as we keep our heart and our mind upon worship.
It is of anything and everything we can give to him. Oh, man, aren't you so glad for what he's done for you? Amen. Oh, we bless his name today. And again, I know some of you came in after the announcements. Just don't want you to forget that our new class, Let's Go Deeper, is starting today. And you have three different classes you can go to. The new one that we're offering would be for some of the more younger families. And it'll be right here in the sanctuary at 10:15. As a reminder, those of you who have an interest in joining the church, I'll be in the fellowship hall at 10:15 looking to meet with you. Especially if you've missed the first or both of the first two meetings, that today's meeting is necessary for you. I want you to turn your Bibles back to Malachi. We were there last week, and we're going to just go back to that passage of Scripture and just share some things the Lord has given us. It's just great seeing all of you again in the house of God. Some of you are probably familiar with the story. Jesus was invited over to a Pharisee's house, and Jesus went there to eat with him. And the Bible says that while Jesus was there at the table, when they were just kind of reclined and his feet were behind him, the Bible says a woman from the city who was a sinner came into that place. And when she got to Jesus, she began to weep. And she cried so much that she actually washed his feet with her tears. And then she took her hair and she dried his feet. She took an alabaster box of ointment and she broke it and she anointed the feet of Jesus with it. The Pharisee that had invited him didn't like what was going on. And the Bible says he said within himself, if this man was a prophet, that's key, if he was really a prophet, he would know what kind of person has touched him because she's a sinner. Within himself, he was asking a question, doubting, is Jesus really a prophet? Regardless of the fact that this woman had to have the courage to come among people who looked down on her in the first place, probably had to say, excuse me, as she walked through the crowd, and yet she made her way to Jesus, and this man is doubting if the Lord's a prophet or not. It doesn't matter the fact that she's convicted so much that she weeps and shows her conviction and wipes the feet of Jesus with her own hair. He still doubts if the Lord's a prophet or not. It didn't matter that her life was changed in such a radical way that she took everything that she possessed, that alabaster box, and she broke it and poured it on the feet of Jesus. This man had doubts if he was a prophet or not. I shared with you last week that sometimes when people have questions like that, whether they're verbal or internal, questions that are sarcastic, questions that are cynical, questions that are insincere, sometimes those questions are actually excuses for them to live life their way instead of God's way. We talked about that last week, remember? Sometimes people will ask questions not because they really want the answer, but because they're trying to justify their own lifestyle. That's what we see in the book of Malachi. I shared with you that Malachi wrote to a group of people, the Jewish people, who had been released from Babylonian captivity. And they'd been back in their homeland for probably 100 years. And now that they were back, they had had time, this is important, they had had time to rebuild their temple. They had time to build a wall around their city. They had time from Ezra and Nehemiah to be reintroduced to the Word of God. But after 100 years or so, they're starting to go backwards. They're starting to forget what God had done for them. And they're starting to get back into sin. And so Malachi comes on the scene, and Malachi just really challenges these people to repent and return to the Lord. And so he talks to them about really six different situations. And with every conversation, this is key, there's always the same structure to the conversation. Malachi declares a truth. The people dispute or question what God has said through Malachi. And then Malachi has to give evidence or demonstration of what God has said. That's what was going on. And you know, it just came to me as I was preparing for this. I shared with you last week. If Malachi gave this prophecy 400 years before John the Baptist came on the scene and saying, prepare the way for the Lord. If he gave this prophecy 400 years or so before Jesus came on the scene saying, repent for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. If he gave this prophecy before Jerusalem was destroyed by the Romans, if he gave this prophecy because people were being cynical and questioning if God is real and he wanted them to repent and return to God, you know, the question today is, what should we be doing as believers today? If we really believe in the Lord's second return, if we really believe it could happen at any time, if we really believe the Lord told us, be ready in such an hour that you think not that the Son of Man is coming, if we really believe that people today can really be cynical as well, if we really believe today, as we do, there's nonsense everywhere, and there's really foolish talk and gestures, and there's people who live with criticism, and there's people who call good bad, and people who call bad good, if we live in a life like that today, what should be our response? Maybe we need to be crying out to people as well. We need to repent and we need to return to the Lord. Maybe we need to return to God and ask him to forgive us of what we've done, because our Lord is coming back sooner than we ever realize. And the Bible declares it's once upon the man to die and then the judgment. If that's what we really believe and we're living around nonsense, then we need to rise up as believers and challenge people today, come back and repent to the Lord. That's where we need to be at. But the questions they're asking are just excuses. We're seeing the same thing today that Malachi saw. People are asking questions just to excuse their personal lifestyle. I'm going to do it my way, regardless of what that preacher may say, regardless of what that book there may say. I'm going to do it this way. And it's sad. And sometimes it breaks your heart. Sometimes it frustrates, at least it does me. Yeah. And you know, I told someone this week, you know, I don't have all the answers, but I know what God gives to me to share with the people. And when you see folks going down different paths, I'm saying, if they could have just obeyed what the Word of God had said, I think it would have helped their situation. Yeah, I really do. And so we learn what can happen when questions become an excuse. This is what was last week, and not to repeat it, you know, or re-preach it. It was sometimes it causes us to doubt God's love. That's what was last week. Today I want to talk to you about it can cause us to dishonor God's name. When questions actually become excuses, they can cause us to dishonor God's name. Look with me in Malachi 1, verse 6 and 7. The Bible says this, reading from the King James Version, a son honoreth his father, and a servant his master. If I then be a father, where is mine honor? And if I be a master, where is my fear? Saith the Lord of hosts unto you, O priest that despise my name. And ye say, wherein have we despised thy name? And the Lord says, ye offer polluted bread upon mine altar, and you say, wherein have we polluted thee? In that you say, the table of the Lord is contemptible. Father, thank you for this time of worship. Thank you for the opportunity to just dive into your word with our folks today. And Lord, you see where each of us are at. And you see the folks that we, Lord, come in contact with throughout the week. So speak to us in the way that we need to hear you the most, Lord. Oh, Lord, just allow your Holy Spirit to comfort if that's what we need. Or, Lord, to convict if that's what we need. Either way, dear Lord, you're God and we look to you. Holy Spirit, speak to us throughout this service. We ask in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. 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 I want to remind you once again, you got to see the structure of the conversation. This happens every time they talk. Malachi declares a truth from God. Malachi says something. And the people dispute it. The people question what Malachi says from God. And then Malachi gives the evidence. He gives the demonstration. This is true what God has said. And today is this. It's dealing with how they dishonored God. And when you look at the scripture, man, they had evidence that God was truly their father. That there was no doubt about it. The Lord speaks up very clearly. He says, if I then be a father, probably the translation would be, if I then be your father. And that probably should be a capital F in other translations. You know, he said, I am your father. And he's asking, where's my honor? You know, the word honor in this text actually means heavy. And it means weight. And it's used in a good sense. He is saying this way. He is giving someone the honor that they deserve. He is giving someone the respect that they deserve. He is giving someone the reverence that they deserve. He is giving someone the obedience that they deserve. Why? Because you feel like they are worthy. And the Lord is saying this to these people. He said, earthly sons and earthly daughters, they honor their fathers because they think their father is worthy. They honor their father by respecting them. They honor their fathers by reverencing them. They honor their fathers by obeying them. Why? Because they feel my father is worthy of all that. And the Lord says, you know, if I'm your father, if I'm your heavenly father, where's my respect? If I'm really your heavenly father, where is my honor? If I'm really your heavenly father, where's the obedience that I should deserve? And I'm going to tell you something, folks. They had no excuse for doubting that God was their heavenly father. I personally believe because of who they were, they were the nation of Israel. I want to believe somewhere down the line, someone told them the story of Abraham, that someone told them the story of the father of their nation. And maybe they said, you know, God was truly a father to Abraham. Just look at his story. I mean, God made sure that he made promises to Abraham. Why? Because that's what fathers do. Fathers know how to make promises to their children. And the Bible says this, you know, Abraham was probably 75 years old. And God says, I want you to leave your father's house. I want you to leave this nation. And I want you to go to a place where I'll show you. Abraham leaves home, but he doesn't see the promise. And later on, he tells him this. He said, I'm going to make a great nation out of you. I'm going to bless you. And I'm going to bless those that bless you. And I'm going to curse those that curse you. And Abraham never sees the promise. He takes his nephew Lot with him. And after a while on the journey, Lot leaves him. But he still hasn't seen the promise. And he's about 86 years old now. And he decides to have a child with his handmaid. And the little boy comes up and, you know, here's a son. Maybe this is going to be the promise. But he still didn't see the promise. And finally, he gets to be 100 years old. And he has a son with his wife. And he names him Isaac. Why? Because God kept his promise. Because that's what fathers do. They had no reason to doubt, regardless of how long it takes, regardless of all the opposition along the way. At some point in time, if daddy said it, daddy's going to do it, because that's what fathers do. He had evidence of it. It didn't stop there. God had seen evidence when God just provided for Abraham. Little Isaac's now probably 14, 15 years old. And God says, Abraham, take your only son, the son of promise, the son that you love. I want you to go to the land of Moriah, and there will be a mountain I'm going to show you, and I want you to offer him as a sacrifice. He leaves with the boy, and God doesn't stop him. Yeah. And the Bible says when he gets close to that area, he tells his servants, you guys stay here. The lad and I are going to go worship, and we're coming back. But God doesn't stop him. And so after a while, he gives Isaac the wood, and he's carrying the fire, and he's carrying the knife, and God still doesn't stop him. And then finally he gets to the place and he binds Isaac and he lays Isaac on the wood and he puts the wood and Isaac on the altar and he stretches his knife back about to take his life. And the Bible says then an angel stopped him and says, I know you fear the Lord. And he looks around and he hears a little noise and there's a lamb caught in the thicket and he named that place Jehovah Jireh because the Lord provides, because that's what fathers do. Fathers provide for the children. They had no reason at all, no reason at all to doubt that God was their heavenly Father. And because they knew who he was, he deserved honor. He deserved all the glory. He deserved all the respect. He deserved obedience, but they were making excuses for not doing it. Can I share something with you? God's not just their Father. God's also our Father. Oh, thank you, Lord. He's our Father. Yeah, but I'm going to tell you about him. Yeah, he listen, folks, he made promises to them, but he also makes promises to us. Yeah, this is what the Bible tells me. He has given us everything that we need for life and godliness. He makes us those promises. His promises are yes and amen in Jesus Christ. He is our Father. And just like he provided for them, he also provides for us. Jesus himself said this, if you on earth know how to give things, you being evil on earth, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more can the Father in heaven give good gifts to you when you ask of him? He provides. Because he's my Father, and that's what fathers do. He doesn't stop there. He's a Father that I can pray to. Yeah. Jesus said when we pray our Father who art in heaven. This almighty God, this all-powerful God, this all-knowing God, he's a personal heavenly Father, and he tells me I can come boldly to the throne of grace that I may obtain mercy and find grace to help in my time of need. I can talk to God anytime. I can talk to God about any situation because he's my Father, and that's what fathers do. Didn't stop there also. Listen, he has placed us as believers into his body. This is what the Apostle Paul said about that. He said, we have received the spirit of adoption, and therefore we can cry, Abba, Father. He is my Father, and he's placed me into his family. He didn't stop there. In my Father's house, there are many mansions. There's a place for me, and there's a place for you. Why? Because that's what fathers do. And because he's our Father, he deserves honor. He deserves glory. He deserves praise. Every time we sing to him, it's because he's worthy. When we stand for him, it's because he's worthy. When we lift up our hands, it's because he's worthy. That's who he is. These people knew all of that. They knew all of that, yet they chose to dishonor God. God said, listen, where's my honor? And it's interesting. Brother Tony, here's your excuse. Wherein have we despised your name? Can you believe they got the audacity to ask God that? Yeah, I mean, it shocks me. I almost feel sorry for them. Yeah, they're crazy. Wherein? Just show me. How have we despised your name? The word despised in this verse is actually the opposite of the word honor. The word despised there means to not attribute value. It means to under, stay with me, it means to undervalue. It means to dishonor. Do you get that? They, in other words, they were not respecting God. They were not reverencing God. They were not obeying God. And this is what's so strange to me. They knew they were God's chosen people. They couldn't deny that. We talked about that last week. They were God's chosen people. They knew the plans God had for them were good and not evil. They knew all the promises God had made for them. They've seen how God had provided for them over the years. They've seen how God had protected them over the years. But yet, when it came to bringing their offering to God, they were dishonoring God. And they wonder, how have we done this? And God said, you have dishonored me. Yeah, you have not valued me. Can I just say it this way? You didn't think I was worthy. God, my Lord. Yeah, after all, After all I've done for you, you don't think I'm worthy. I called you a people when you were not a people, but I'm not worthy. I have had a plan for you from the beginning, but you don't think I'm worthy. I have made you promises that will never end, and you don't think I'm worthy. I have protected you over it, but you don't think I'm worthy. I have done all kinds of things, but you don't think I am worthy. And they're saying, what do you mean, God? God, what do you mean? Here's how you've done it. When you have polluted my altar. Amen. And that's the same word for despise. Same word in the Hebrew. Yeah. When you polluted the altar, you despise. Here's what was going on. God required Old Testament sacrifices. And God was very clear about what that sacrifice should be. God said, listen, when you come, you bring your first fruits to me. That's what God was saying. When you come to me, when you bring these animal sacrifices, don't bring it. It's real. Do not bring the blemished. Yeah, don't bring the broken. Don't bring the feeble. Don't bring the sick. You know, you're going to bring me your best when you come. That's what God said. And the Bible declares in these verses, they were bringing the blind and they were bringing the lame and they were bringing the sick. I don't know what they were doing with the best. I don't know if they were going to keep it and eat it. I don't know if they were going to sell it and make some money off of it. I don't know what their thought was, but they didn't bring it to God. They didn't bring God their best. They were bringing God their second best. They were bringing God what was left over. After they did everything they wanted to do, if there's a little bit left, well, we'll give God that maybe. And God says, I am not going to receive this. Instead, I'm going to reject this. If you read on, I'm going to even curse this because you're dishonoring me. If you want to know how we dishonor the name of God, it's when we don't bring our best to God. That's what he was saying. Oh, it was that way with Cain and Abel. You've stirred the story of those brothers. Yeah. But both of these boys, I mean, they had the same mama. They had the same daddy. The first people technically born on the earth, I guess, was these two little fellows here. And they grow up. And over time, Cain, the Bible tells us, tilled the ground. That means he was a farmer. Abel took care of the sheep, so he was a shepherd. And as time passed on, the Bible says they both brought an offering to God. And when I study it, folks, it's like this. You know, because Cain worked in the field, he brought an offering from the field. And because Abel worked with the sheep, he brought an offering from the sheep. Now, I don't want to, you know, mess us up theologically here. I don't think it was necessarily a matter of where the offering was coming from. I think it was really the heart it was coming with. Yeah. I don't think it was whether it was grain or crops or sheep or goat. I think it was more of a heart issue. Why? Because the Bible says this. The Bible says in Hebrews, by faith, it says by faith, Abel offered a more excellent sacrifice to God. So here's what it looks like to me. It's time for the offering. And Cain, maybe he don't think about it. Cain doesn't pray about it. You know what? He said, it's time for the offering. Let me just grab something right here. This'll do. Yeah. This'll do. Yeah. After all, I'm going to just put it on an altar. It's going to be burned up anyway. I mean, that's going to be the end of it. I mean, yeah, matter of fact, let me get something else. This'll be all right. I'll just bring this to God. And the Bible says his offering, what was despised. His offering was rejected. God did not accept it. But then we got Abel on the other hand. Now remember, scripture says he did it by faith. Maybe Abel, I'm going to stretch you a little bit, but maybe Abel says it's time for the offering. And he looks over all those sheep and he's thinking, God's being good to me. Oh, just look at all God's done for me. You know what? I can give God anything I want to do, but that one. Yeah, he was born first. He's a little taller than the other ones, but that's what God needs. He's a little heavier than the other ones, but that's what God needs. Maybe he thinks about it. Maybe he prays about it. He says, you know what? I'm not going to get this back because what's going to happen is I'm going to have to kill this little lamb. And I know it could be sold, but you know, if I give this one to God, I believe God will provide for me in the future. And he just lays that little lamb and he puts him on the altar and he gives it to God, and he sacrifices that. And maybe in his mind, he's thinking about something that his mama and daddy taught him. You know, maybe Adam and Eve says, son, there was a time in life we walked with God and we talked with God and we really messed up. And we tried to cover our sins, you know, with our own fig leaves. It didn't work because God needed to get a little closer to us. And so what God did, he actually killed some animals somehow. He gave us the skins and that sacrifice was made. And it's pointing to what his son Jesus is going to do one day. And so maybe he's thinking about all that. And maybe that's where the theology of it comes in. That I'm not just going to give God any old thing. I'm going to give him a sacrifice. I'm going to let some blood be shed. And I'm going to have some skin in the game. And I'm going to take what means something to me. And I'm going to bring it to God. And God accepted his sacrifice because that's what he was supposed to do. You know, listen, it was a heart issue because it reflected how they were approaching God. It reflected on their mind toward God. It reflected on their thoughts toward God. And so when he gave his very best, he was saying, I want to honor God with the best I've got. I want to give God the very best I've got. And God accepted his sacrifice. You know, here's where we are at today. We need to really ask ourselves, when we approach God, what does it look like? How do we really come to the Lord? Can I just really, if you'll just pardon me, just to really get personal. When it comes to our worship, how are we really approaching God? Does our worship reflect a heart that's sacrificial, or does it reflect a heart that's just full of excuses? You know what I mean? You know, because here's what excuses look like. You know what? It's not about God. It's about me looking good today. Yeah, it's about our program. It's about our performance. So we just grab any old song. This'll do. We just grab any old song. Yeah, you know, I think last time I preached that made people jump. I think that would be a good message to preach today. Yeah. And you know, those songs make people stand and clap. That might be good today. And so there's no sacrifice involved at all because what we want to do, we want to do it our way. Yeah, our worship is just an excuse for us to get our praise on. Yeah. And so we'll do anything we can to stimulate the crowd. You know, we can lower the lights and we can even bring in the smoke if we want to. And you know, we can take off the ties and the jackets and we can put on any old thing that we want to. Just grab any old thing that we can put our hands on to and say, yeah, we're going to bring it to God. God's not going to honor that. And God's not going to bless that. It's not what we're bringing. It's the heart that we bring it with. Because it's not for him. It's all for us. And we're doing it our way instead of God's way. But I'm going to tell you something. When our worship is a sacrifice, man, we'll make a sacrifice because I want to worship him in spirit. And I want to worship him in truth. We'll make a sacrifice to pray over what we're going to sing about. We'll make a sacrifice to pray about what we need to preach about. We'll make a sacrifice to make sure it's pleasing God. Because what we want to do at the end of the day is not please ourselves. We want to enter into his presence. Yeah. And we want to have an encounter with him. And we want to leave this place changed in the name of Jesus. So what does worship look like? We assemble, most of us, every week. Is it a sacrifice or is it an excuse? I'm being honest. Are we coming? So I don't want Pastor to call me this week. I better be here. If I don't go, she's going to nag at me the rest of the day. Yeah, I mean, honestly, are we coming because it's a sacrifice to honor God or is it an excuse? Hear me well. If it's a sacrifice, it's going to be accepted by God. If it's an excuse, it's going to be rejected by God. It doesn't stop there. How about our walk with God? You know, what happens when we leave these doors? Is it a sacrifice or is it an excuse? I know I'm getting real personal at this point, but what's it like when we go to work? What's it like when we're at school? What's it like when we're in the marketplace? What's it like when we're in the gym or Walmart at a grocery store, whatever? What's it like there for us? Is our walk really a sacrificial walk to honor God, or are we just making an excuse to do whatever we want to do? Yeah, I'm being real with you right here. Yeah, because this is what a sacrifice looks like in your daily walk. It means, you know what, of everything I've got to do today, what I'm going to do first is make a sacrifice to have an appointment with God. Yes. Because if I walk out those doors and I have not met with Him, it doesn't matter what life will bring, it's not going to go well for me. And so there needs to be a sacrifice that I spend a little time in prayer just talking to God before I ever talk to people. There needs to be a sacrifice of getting into the Word of God and hearing from God before I ever meet people. And sometimes we won't make those kind of sacrifices. What we do, we make an excuse. Well, I'll grab a word today, and if I miss it today, I'll grab one next week. A preacher will give me a word on Sunday. I'll grab a word somewhere or another. How about prayer? Well, I don't have time, but I'll grab a prayer a little, and we'll just do things that we can put our hands on, and it's just an excuse. How about when we meet with people? Is there a desire in our life to really be salt and light in this world? I mean, with all the nonsense that's going on, and if I can just be as bold as saying this is as candid, from what I hear from people, from some of the nonsense that's going on social media, and from some of the just the ignorant stuff that's in the news today, and I can just say it this way, even some of the stupidity that's going on in the world around us, when I hear stuff like that, shouldn't it make me want to be a solid Christian? Shouldn't it want me to be, if I really know my God is coming back one day, shouldn't I want to be a little bit different than the world around us? But if it's just an excuse, any old thing to do. Yes, sir. Well, if I'm at church, I'm a Christian. Yeah. If I'm in the gym, I'm not so much a Christian. Yeah. And if I'm in the marketplace and you get in front of me, I'm definitely not a Christian. Yeah. But we come back to church and we want to get our shout on. Yeah. We want an experience then. I'm going to tell you something. I think we were in a workshop yesterday, Sister Joy and myself, and we learned that, you know, what happens in the private time is going to help dictate and determine what happens in the corporate time. Amen. Yeah. Yes. So, yeah, listen to me, folks. If there's no time alone with the Lord during the week, it's going to really hurt what happens when we're all together. Yeah. And then you make the job hard on these folks up here. I mean, they're singing their voices out to God. And you say, well, after a while, I know they'll sing one that blesses me to be sure before it's over with. And yeah, I mean, maybe next week he'll be in the New Testament. I follow that a little bit better. Oh, man. But when we spend time with him, and it's a sacrifice. I get it. It's a sacrifice. That means, yeah, you got to deny yourself. Sometimes it means we get up a few minutes earlier. Sometimes we go to bed a little bit later. Sometimes we miss a meal. Maybe we miss two, because our time with God is just that much more important. Listen, these folks, they were making excuses for the lifestyle they wanted to live. And in doing that, they were dishonoring God. At the end of the day, they wanted an excuse so they didn't have to bring God his best. I could get a little bit more into your business if I wanted to. Yeah. You know, we all need those vacations. I get that. But we don't have to take them once a month, you know. I'm being honest. It's okay. You don't have to say amen. Yeah. I get that. Yeah, and you know, sometimes we can't do this, can't do that, because we're just not willing to make the sacrifice to bring God our best. I could go on and on about our work that we do for God, about the way we witness for God, but won't we just stop right there? What does your worship look like? Let's don't compare it to Brother Tony or Sister Joy or Brother Jonathan or Pastor Mark. If worship, the only worship we saw was the example that you gave, what would it look like? Is that okay? Can I ask that? Yeah, I'll ask it again. If our worship of this church was based just on your individual worship, what would it look like? Now, before you say, oh, Pastor, I'm not I don't have the personality type. And that's not what I'm asking you. What they were bringing was not where they were from. It was their heart, remember? So when the Lord looks at your heart in worship, what would he see? Is that okay to ask that way then? Not about how loud you get. Not about how far you run or how high you jump. No. Just what does the heart look like? And only you and God know that, folks. And I'm saying, if it's not a heart of sacrifice, if it's a heart of excuses, well, then it's not going to please God. And it's not going to be accepted to him. How about our walk? How about our walk with God? What does God see in our heart? What does he see? We have to ask ourselves today, am I really honoring God or am I dishonoring him? I don't know really how to close this out. I want to give an invitation for the unsaved, but I feel like I just need to pray for our church. You know, my dad, some of you know, he has a reupholstery business. Daddy's been there since 1966. 84 years old, man, works Monday through Saturdays most week. I was with him the other day, and we were getting something to eat, and the older man came in on a walker. He looked at me, he said, I see the face. I just can't put a name on it. I didn't try to explain who I was. You know what I did? I tapped my dad on the shoulder, and I said, I'm his son. I belong to him. And I hope when you see me, I hope you see him. When I lay my hands on those furniture, those chairs at his place, when they see my work, I hope they see my dad's work. Because after 66 years, whatever, you know, in the business, I don't want to embarrass him. I don't want to dishonor him. I don't want to bring him shame. I want his name to continue on because that's just how good he is. Here's something I got to get today, though. If we have been born again, we're children of God. When people look at us, let's point them back to our Father. Let's don't embarrass him. Come on, guys. Let's don't dishonor God. And we can do it so easy. Sometimes we make so many excuses. Oh, that's just my personality. Get sanctified. Yeah. Be filled with the Holy Spirit. Yeah, come on. Let's get over ourselves. And let's point people back to God. Let's represent him. Let's don't dishonor him. Well, everybody does it. Everybody's not going to heaven. But we say we are. Let's live a way that would honor God. Well, you don't know what they did to me. No, I don't. But I know what Jesus did for you. He left heaven. He came to earth. And he died on the cross for your sins. And if you get to heaven, it's by the blood of Jesus Christ. And if they get there, it's by the blood of Jesus Christ. And by God, if we can go to heaven together, to be sure we can love each other on this side of the grave. I'm sorry. Sometimes it just bothers me. We profess all this stuff, but when it comes to practice, are we honoring God or dishonoring God? Bow your heads. I've got to stop. Father, we love you, Lord. Thank you that you are our Heavenly Father. Thank you, dear Lord, that we have not chosen you, but you have chosen us according to Jesus Christ. Thank you, dear God, that we are new creations in you. Thank you, dear God, that we've been redeemed from the curse of the law by the blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Thank you, dear God, that we have been reconciled into a relationship with you because of Jesus Christ. Thank you, dear Lord, that we've been adopted into your family because of our relationship with Jesus Christ. Lord, it's my prayer today that everyone listening to me, myself included, dear God, Lord God, that we would be in practice what we are in position. Lord, help us to live it out, to walk it out, not just talk it, but to live it, to be the best that we can be for you. Oh, Lord, we just humble ourselves before you today. You are so worthy. Forgive us when we've made worship about us. Forgive us, dear God, when we walked our way instead of your way. Forgive us, dear God, when we've been an ineffective witness for you. Forgive us, dear God, when our work was to bring pats to our back and not fingers pointed to you. Forgive us, dear God. Forgive us today, dear God. Help us to be the Christians you've called us to be. We thank you. Could you just begin to pray your own way right now? I don't know what you might need to repent of. Maybe you just need to rejoice. Maybe you just need to pray for your pastor. Maybe you need to pray for the person beside you. But can we just take another minute and ask God to reveal to us if there's an area in our life that we have not honored Him, that we have not given Him our best. Oh, God, show us today. Show us today. Show us today, dear God. Draw the reins of our heart. Help us today. You're so worthy, dear God. You're so worthy. We bless You and we praise You. And I speak blessings over this congregation, blessings over our online family. Lord, we ask You that through the help of the Holy Spirit, that we would honor You from morning to evening, throughout the night, at work, at play, wherever we are, at any time of the day, that we live a life that reflects our heart towards You. We love You and we praise You. And we speak these blessings now over our church family. For it's in the mighty name of Your Son, Jesus, we ask these things. May the people of God say, amen. Amen. We love you, folks. May God bless you. May He keep you. Encourage you to please try to stay for one of those classes for us, okay? Thank you so much for being with us today.